Good morning. It's good to see each one of you here for the Lord's Day, and what a wonderful way to start off God's day with the serving of the ordinance of baptism, which is one of two of Baptists, the other being the Lord's Supper. Baptism is a symbol that somebody has come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, and they've come to be buried with him, to be raised with him, to walk in the newness of life. And what a blessing it is today to have two young men to come to be baptized. And I have the joy of baptizing a great nephew of mine, and he asked that I do it. That's reading the old man's up here in the baptistry again this morning. But that's a joy. It was a thrill of my heart that he would like for me to baptize him. In the Word of God, we find in Matthew, the third chapter, it says, then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to see me? But Jesus answered him, let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented, and when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest upon him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Let us pray. Father, we are grateful today that these two young men have come to accept you as Lord and Savior, and they've come today to, Father, be an example and a show and to demonstrate to the world that they've accepted you by going through the waters of baptism. And I ask your blessings upon their lives, that you would protect them and watch over them and care for them. And Father, just grant them wisdom to make those decisions in life that would be pleasing to you. Father, grant them wisdom to follow the roadmap of God's word as they develop and grow in maturity in their faith. Bless this service today, Father. And God, if there be one here today that does not know you as Lord and Savior, that this might be the day of salvation. And God, will be careful to give you the honor for everything you do. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Dylan, what is your testimony?
The Lord is my Savior.
The Lord is my Savior. That's true. Because as you walk through these baptismal waters, you want to make sure that at one point in your life, you've confessed Christ as your Lord and Savior. In obedience to the command of the Lord Jesus Christ, upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are buried with Christ, but we are raised to walk in the newness of life. Go and do likewise. God bless.
And like Pastor Frank shared a moment ago, it's a joy to stand in these trembling waters as a symbol of an outward display of an inward reality. And it's my joy to be here with Joey Smith. He's a dear friend of mine that we met maybe 2 months ago as he showed up to Memorial Day service and said, hey, I want to help with VBS. Famous last words, I guess. And since then, he's been hanging out with me. He's had time to hang out with Pastor Anthony as well. Endured camp with us as well, and while I was there, he decided to let go and let God, so to speak. And so, Joey, at this time, I'd like to ask you, what is your public profession of faith?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
And so based upon your public profession of faith in the Jesus as Lord, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in his likeness, raised to walk in newness of life. Will y'all pray with me? Lord, we thank you for this day where these two were so bold as to publicly state faith in you. And let them know at this point that you are with them always, you dwell with them in all times and in all things. And as they looked out from these waters, they saw a family of believers to walk alongside them, to encourage them, to uplift them, and to hold them righteous for their account. And we ask now that you be in this worship service as we glorify you. For it's in your Son's precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
All God's people said, let me ask you, stands we join together singing, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Holy, holy. Amen. I'm not what I was. Amen. I'm not what I will be, Amen. But I'm not what I was. I'm something completely new. And the endless grace of God washing over us is how we move in this life as a Christian. If you're our guest today for the first time in a long time, we want to say welcome to you. We are glad that you have come to be a part of our worship today. We look forward to getting to know you and who you are. And the first step in that is you will find a connection card in your pew back in front of you, a yellow connection card. We would like for you to fill that card out and drop it in the offering plate when it goes around. If you have any questions, we'll try to answer those. And we'd love to see a report of your visit here this morning with us. So please be sure to fill that out and drop it in the offering plate. Well, are you glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Okay, well then let's stand together. Let's fellowship one with another. Tell somebody hello. Tell them you love them. Tell them you're glad to see them.
Thank you for another beautiful, glorious day you gave us, Father. Thank you for all your blessings you give us each and every day. Now is the time to give a little bit back to you, Father, and to use for your will and to make your kingdom better, Father. And all this we ask in your holy name. Amen.
Healer, more than the healing. Help me want the Jesus more than anything.
Please stand as we join together singing one I know many of y'all love. It's Days of Elijah.
Every day of the month.
Singing that song about breathing in God's grace and then breathing it out. I was thinking about how we're not worthy to receive that grace and how that grace washes over us anyway. And how because that grace has washed over us and we've been made into a new creature, as we've already sung about this morning, there ought to be something remarkably and noticeably different about our lives. There ought to be a level of grace that is coming from us that the world is able to recognize. There's something different about that human being, that person. And so as we look at our text today, that's exactly what we are calling, or what God is calling on us to do through this particular passage. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you today so eternally grateful for your grace, for it's an amazing grace. It's a grace that we're not worthy to receive. It's a grace that washes over us and changes us from the inside out. A spirit that makes us alive together with Christ. And we know that we've died with the old self and that we've been raised to walk in newness of life. And so, Father, as we open your word this morning and study a little bit more about what you're calling us to be and how you're calling us to live, I pray, God, that you will help us to apply these truths to our lives, to apply these truths to our understanding of how we should walk, and understand, Lord, that there is a noticeable, discernible change that takes place in our life because of grace. And if that change is not there, then life has not been given to us. We've not been made new if we have not been changed. And so, Father, I pray, God, that as we study this morning, you'll help these words to impact our souls to the very core and help us to become more like you each and every day. Now, Father, we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can turn with me in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3 and verse 7. We'll begin reading there in just a moment. But in our study of the book of Colossians, we have seen that we have died with our old self and with Christ. We've been buried with Christ, and we've been raised to new life. And we've had a few baptisms over the course of the last few weeks that remind us that's exactly what this symbol is, that this picture is a symbol of our dying to our old self with Christ, just like he died on the cross, being buried with him, and then raised again to walk in a new life. And when we're saved, we are made into something with a new heart, a new focus, and a focus is God. Last week, we said that Paul has moved from his doctrinal portion of the letter and is now moving to the very practical portion of the letter. Sometimes we need to know some things about what God requires of us, how God calls us to live, but before we can obey those things, we have to understand the doctrinal rationale behind them. Why does God call us to do these things? Because he's changing us. He's transforming us. And so he deals with doctrine and says, here's what you need to know, and here's why you need to know it, so you can apply it to your life. And so we're now in the very practical application portion of the letter. And since we've died to the old self, now we must put to death anything in us that resembles the old self. That makes perfect sense to me. We have died to sin's penalty. We no longer have to face the penalty of sin. Jesus took our penalty upon himself, but we understand that the power of sin is still in the world. God doesn't, as soon as we're saved, remove us from the world and take us to heaven. Now, that might be a desirable thing for us, so we wouldn't have to face the sin and the suffering and the pain and the death that this world brings, this sinful world brings, but God doesn't do that. He leaves us here. And so the power of sin is still running rampant in the world. The power of sin is still remaining in our fleshly bodies, even though our spirit has been changed. And so there is this sinful world that we live in that has the power strong of sin. We've died to sin's penalty, but sin's power remains. And so we must continually put sin to death. The way that we put sin to death, though, is not the way you might think. A lot of people think the way that you put sin to death is by pulling yourself up by your bootstraps as a Christian. You know, by becoming a legalist, if you will. Now, I've known some legalist Christians in my life, and they weren't very pleasant people to be around. They were always being critical. They were always, focused on other people's sin rather than their own. They were judgmental. By the way, let me just remind you of something. You can't worship God and be critical at the same time, because if you're critical, you're really not worshiping. It's really not about God. It's really not about you and God. It's about you and other folks. So we need to be aware that God is calling us to focus on the right way to put sin to death, not by focusing on a legalistic approach to rules and regulations. We approach by allowing the Holy Spirit to change us from the inside out. You know, it's not about the outward. It's about the inside. If you get the inside right, the outside will come. If you get the heart right, the motive right, and the spirit working in you right, then the outside will come. And so as Christians, we are obligated by our new nature to put sin to death. And if you don't feel an obligation to put the old self to death in your Christian walk, then you might not have a Christian walk. There should be a desire, a change of our orientation from ourselves to God. This means that we must make a decision to bring the flesh under the Spirit, under the will and submission to the Spirit-filled nature. By the way, I was just thinking about a particular passage of Scripture where Paul tells the Romans to not be drunk with wine, instead to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, that in our Baptist churches, that's our verse of Scripture where we go, yeah, don't drink. But really, that verse has a lot to do with the Spirit and less to do with drinking. By the way, I'm not saying that you can drink. Don't be a bunch of drunks. That's bad. No, but he's saying don't be drunk with wine. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. The analogy that Paul is making there is that what happens when you're drunk with wine or drunk with something? It controls you. It impairs you and controls you, and that thing is what you're slave to. And so what he's saying there, don't be drunk with wine. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. What he's saying is allow the Spirit to control you, just like you would allow alcohol to control you if you were drunk with wine. And so the idea here is that we're to be controlled by the Spirit, and we're not to be focused on ourselves as much as we are to be seeking Jesus first. And so we're not talking about that legalistic approach. 2 weeks ago, we said the first step to spiritual maturity is seeking Christ first. You got to seek Christ. You know, a lot of people come to me and say, well, I'm really struggling. I'm really going through this. I'm really going through that. Well, how are you trying to deal with it? Well, I'm doing this. I'm doing this. I'm doing this. But listen, the solution is simple. Seek Christ first. Seek Him first. And He will help you with all that other stuff. And so last week, we looked at a specific kind of sin that we are to put to death by seeking Christ first, and that was perverted love. This week, we'll move to another group of sins that are associated with wicked hate. Last week was perverted love, how we pervert our love of people and things. And this week, we'll talk about how we have wicked hatred in our heart. Look at Colossians chapter 3 and verse 7 and read that with me. Let's stand together in honor of the reading of God's Word. If you can, if you can't, we know you honor God's word from where you are. In these, you two once walked when you were living in them, but now you must put them all away. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you put off the old self with its practices and have to put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek or Jew or circumcised or uncircumcised or barbarian or Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all in all. Father, bless the reading and study of your word today. Apply it to our lives and help us to be transformed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, last week we said, if you look back at verse number 6, you say, on account of these things, the wrath of God is coming. And then he goes, in these two you once walked when you were living in them. So in these two verses, we find out why we must put sin to death. First, the sin that is in our lives brings the wrath of God. So sin brings the wrath of God. So we need to understand that. Sin, I'm going to give you something, all right? I'm going to give you something here. You can go away with this, and this is going to be good information. You read? Sin is bad. And a lot of times we say, well, we know that, but just how bad is it? You may ask. Did you ask that? How bad is it? It's so bad, it separates us from God for all eternity. It's so bad that the wrath of God is being poured out on us. And when Jesus came, he said he didn't come to condemn the world because it was condemned already. It was already under the wrath of God. Sin is so bad that it creates such a separation between us and God that we will be separated from him for all eternity unless something happens in our lives. So sin is bad and brings the wrath of God. The second thing he says here in our verse today, verse 7, is that it's part of our past. Sin is part of our past. Why would anyone who has tasted the riches of God's glory want to go back to the past? Why does anyone who has been transformed and has seen the glory of God want to go back and wallow in the sins of their past? How can a new creature act like an old one? So then we must put everything earthly to death in us. Today we'll take a close look at these sins of wicked hate. I don't want to spoil all the fun for you because you've got your little outline with some blanks in there. But if you just read the text, those are the answers to your blank, okay? So the first one we're going to look at is anger. Anger, I want you to know these sins that we're looking at are not so much personal as they are social. Last week when we talked about a perverted love, there are some forms of perverted love that are social in that they impact someone else. So if you commit sexual sin with someone, you can impact someone else. But some of these perverted love sins that we looked at last week could actually just be in the mind, you know, some thoughts, some lustful thoughts and things like this. Well, anger has to do with social aspect, and much more often these things are manifested in that they impact someone else. So what he's saying here is that we need to put aside these things. Those of you who have spent some time outside this summer working in the heat of the day, I know that you might get out there and you get sweaty and you get filthy and everything. And when you come in the house, the first thing you do after maybe getting something cold to drink is you take off all those nasty, filthy clothes, don't you? You just strip them off. Well, that's what he means to put something off. Just strip it off. So we put off these sinful things here. Anger that he's speaking of here is a deep, smoldering, resentful bitterness. A deep, smoldering, resentful bitterness. It is the settled heart attitude of an angry person. This is what an angry person decides to have in their heart, is just simply a deep, smoldering, resentful bitterness. And when an angry person lashes out at someone else, they're not creating anger in that moment. They are simply reacting to that anger that's already in their heart. So anger is something that lies under the surface, something that was already present. Jesus himself addressed anger in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 and 22, when he says, "You have heard it said to those of old, 'You shall not murder,' and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hellfire." Jesus sees anger as in the heart. Now, there may be anger in our heart that never leads to actions. Likely that's not true. But there may be anger in our heart that never actually leads to action. But even those people that are angry, that are passive-aggressive, that is, they display their anger in snide comments and you know, passive-aggressive ways, they're still doing something, see? They're still reacting to the anger. So usually anger does come out, but it's a heart issue here. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 26 to 27, Paul tells us whether it's ever appropriate for a Christian to be angry. He says, "Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil." So there is a righteous form of anger that Christians can have, but the form of anger that is unrighteous is when we are, you know, we're emotional beings, and when we allow our emotions to control us, when we allow our emotions to determine our decisions in life, that's when we act out wrongly on that anger. Now, we can get angry when we are wronged or when we see people that we love are wronged. But the difference between proper anger and improper anger is the motivation behind it. You know, if you are upset at the situation that your family's in and you're angry about it, or upset at a situation you're in and you're angry about it, you may be justified in that anger. But if you're thinking about the person who has caused that anger and want a piano to fall from heaven onto them, that's not good. I've thought about that before with a couple of guys I went to high school with, but that was a long time ago. And I don't know why it was a piano, but it was a baby grand, just like that. God is angry many times in Scripture at situations, and God is even angry at people. But His anger is always a righteous anger. And so we're to be angry at sin, and we're to be angry at the things that God is angry at, but we're not to direct our anger towards another person. We're to put aside anger. He goes on to talk about wrath. Now, wrath, or another good way to translate this would be rage. Rage or wrath is a sudden outburst of anger. Now, the Greeks are relating this type of wrath to fire on straw. You know, when you throw straw into a fire and it flames up real quick and then it kind of goes out. That's what wrath is, something that just an outburst, a quick outburst that boils over. It's really described as anger boiling over, and it is used to describe those who erupt in anger at Jesus of Nazareth for His teaching, those Ephesian craftsmen who caused a riot because of what Paul was teaching and preaching. That is the type of wrath that we're talking about here. So it's a sudden outburst of anger. It's a churning and boiling anger that lies just below the surface and gives rise to an eruption of wrath. Anger and wrath are closely related. Many believers live in a state of anger and are prone to eruptions of wrath. This should never be. We have not been called to be angry at one another and to lash out at one another. You know, Jesus Himself told us to love one another. John was a big stickler for the teaching of loving one another, because by our love for one another, we show the world how the kingdom of heaven really should be. But when we disagree with one another and we lash out at each other in anger, that shows the world that we're really not all that loving of a people, and we really never have been changed in the right way. There is a way to disagree about things without being disagreeable. But I would even go a step further than that. I would say we can disagree with each other in Christ-like love. Love others the way Christ has loved us, being willing to give yourself up for them. It doesn't make sense to me, though, for that Christian that's angry all the time. I really have a question about the seriousness of their relationship with the Lord, or the evidence of their relationship at all, if a person who claims to be a Christian is potentially angry all the time. Talked to a guy one time and said, "Well, you know, I've just lived a long life, and I deserve to be respected at this point in my life." Well, maybe you should give a little respect and you'll get a little respect. Maybe you should act like a human being that loves other people, and maybe people will love you and treat you with respect. But if you're always grumbling and complaining and griping and lashing out and all that about every single thing, then you miss the point of who we're called to be as Christians. We should never allow the anger to churn below the surface where it erupts in wrath. Thirdly, malice. Malice. Malice is just really translates as general moral evil. That's really what this is. So it's just a very general term. I won't spend much time here, but J.B. Lightfoot defines it as the vicious nature which is bent on doing harm. So this is the idea where we're generally just wanting others to be harmed. We're generally wanting others to be maligned in some way, and it rejoices when someone else has misery in their lives. You know, we often say misery loves company. Maybe the person that has this type of malice in their heart is miserable and just wants other people to be miserable. But it sometimes leads, this malice, for people to plan ways to be evil to other people, to tear others down so maybe they can lift themselves up. You know, a lot of times we think in terms of making other people look bad so we'll look better. Now, sometimes we don't know we're exactly doing that, but that's really what it is when you tear somebody else down. You're trying to elevate yourself, and so what you're really doing here is not so much just being sinful against that person, but you're really being prideful about yourself. It's a vicious cycle, it is. We should seek to lift up other people. We should seek to honor other people, especially when they're serving the Lord well. And in that way, I believe that we get lifted up. Slander and obscene talk, number four, as these two are together, because they deal with our speech, two forms of evil speech. The first word, slander, is translated from the Greek term blasphema, where we get the word blaspheme from. So it is a word that is often used to talk about dishonoring or disrespecting God, but it's used here to talk about disrespecting another human being. And so it's translated as slander. Why use this word to talk about people when it's an idea that's predominantly used to talk about God? Well, the idea here is that when we talk about people in a way that does not honor them or disrespects them, then we are tearing them down and tearing their character down, as I just mentioned a moment ago. And here's the thing. All people are created in the image of God. And when you seek to tear someone else down, you're really tearing God down. Now, that doesn't mean that every action of human beings is righteous. We know it's not. In fact, we even know in our own lives, not every action is righteous. But the believer's speech must not be used in a way that disrespects God, dishonors him, and disrespects his creation, and dishonors him. James chapter 3 and verse 10 says, "From the same mouth come blessing and cursing." My brothers, these things ought not to be so. Listen, we are called to live better than that. We're not called to talk about people and tear them down with our speech. Next, Paul mentions obscene talk. And this simply could be translated as obscene talk that is meant to cause harm to other people. And it really could be translated as abusive speech. So it's when we abuse others with our language. So this is not so much as directed as about a person when we're talking to someone else, but toward a person when we're talking to them. Abusive speech. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 4 says, "Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead let there be thanksgiving." Listen, if we focus on God, we'll never have time to tear somebody else down. If we're seeking Jesus first, we're going to seek Jesus best for that person that has caused us problems in our lives. Listen, let me just give you a little bit of a clue to life. And young people, you listen up. All right, y'all listening? People will do things that upset you. People will do things that you don't agree with. But that never means that we should talk about them or be abusive in our speech. Listen, if you look around at what is going on in our world today, there's a blatant lack of respect for other people. I mean, when I was a kid, we were taught to say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, and yes, sir, and no, sir. And even if it was a grumpy old man, we were to say sir to him. And we weren't ever to tell him he was stupid. But you see some of these folks at these rallies, and they're lashing out at each other and yelling at each other and screaming at the top of their lungs and not giving each other respect. We can't have a decent conversation these days because everybody's offended by everything. And so because of that, people have stepped down and they don't respect one another. Listen, we are called as Christians to treat one another with respect and love. And we're called to treat the world with respect and love, even if they disagree with us. Christians may be having opportunities to confront others about the sin in their lives. We're called to do that, by the way. I could get into a whole lot of stuff right here. I'm not going to do it because I got two more things to talk about today. But the idea that we treat each other with respect and confront each other about our sin from time to time, that we do so in love and not in a critical, mean-spirited nature, and we are never called to abuse one another with our words. We must not use our words to wound people. We must not use our words to destroy someone else's character. We must love one another with our words as well. Dishonesty, number five. The final sin that Paul warns us about is lying. We know God is the God of truth, and he calls us not to lie. In fact, it's so important that it's one of the top 10 list of things we're to do or not to do in relation to God. One of the 10 commandments is do not lie. And we need to understand it's a sin against God, you know, but it's also a sin against others. By the way, Satan is called the father of lies. And when we lie, we're participating in the path of Satan. As believers, we are called to conform our lives to the image of Christ. But when we lie, we are not conforming our lives to the image of Christ. We're conforming ourselves to the image of Satan. We must put aside all dishonesty, even the little white lies that we tell from time to time are just misrepresenting ourselves. All of these types of things are evil. Now let's look at the rationale for just a moment. And this is really, if you want to look with me at verse 9, the second half of verse 9. He says, do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices, and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge and in the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek or Jew, circumcision or uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and in all. In these verses, Paul gives us the reasons why we're to put aside earthly things. All genuine believers have a new self. We are putting that old self off and putting that new self on. We're redressing ourselves with the ways of Christ. And so we need to think about God. We need to think about setting our minds on the things above. We need to think about what God is calling us to do for an impact on eternity. And we need to be being renewed in the knowledge after the image of our Creator, the text says. Renewed in the knowledge after the image of our Creator. We need to be changed. We need to be transformed. And as we grow, we should be in a constant state of growth and make a constant effort for our lives to be a picture of the Creator. A couple of verses. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16 says, so we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. We're to be renewed day by day after the image of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, for we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Paul says here that the reason that we're to put off the old self and put on the new is because it radically changes the human relationship. You have a bad relationship with your boss or someone that you know, maybe a neighbor you're having trouble with. The gospel of Jesus Christ radically changes how we relate to other people. I know that race relations in our country have been a terrible situation in our past history. From slavery, the McCarthy Doctrine, and ultimately the civil rights movement of the 1960s. But honestly, in my lifetime, it seems like they're getting worse. I think people are inflaming them. I think that's what's going on. I think, you know, they say that the way that you do things today is divide and conquer. I think some in power want to divide us. But listen, as Christians, we have hope. And look at what he says here. There is no Greek or Jew or circumcised or uncircumcised or barbarian or Scythian or slave or free, but Christ is all and in all. It doesn't matter what your social background is. It doesn't matter what your race is. It doesn't matter how much money you make. All that matters is Christ. And we are all the same. We're sinners saved by grace. When Jesus returns, he's going to set all things right. And he's going to make everything right. And people of all skin tones and socioeconomic backgrounds will understand that we're really all one race. We all came from Adam. Every single one of us. We're all one race. We're the human race. And those that are, there's only two types of people in the world. Christians and those who need to be saved, lost people. So we need to get past this racist idea, especially in the church, above all in the church. Because God doesn't use our skin tone or our background as a measure of our salvation. You know what He uses? The blood of Jesus. We're to love all people, regardless of their actions, regardless of their skin color, and if they show us, regardless of their bank statement. Sometimes you can tell what their bank statement's like, though, by the cars they drive, kind of thing. So how do we put off the old self? Well, first, we seek God above all else. We put Him first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God is what Jesus said, and all these things will be added unto you. The paraphrase I like to say is, seek God first and everything else will work itself out. Second, we do not need to feed the evil impulses that we've talked about the last 2 weeks, like perverted love and wicked hate. We have to choose to love like God has called us to love, and we must choose not to hate. Throw it away. Take it off. Third, we must crowd out the sins of this old self with the righteousness of God. Here's what He says in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Put your mind on the things of God and you won't have time for all the sins of the world. Seek Him first. We must let the word of Christ richly dwell within us. By the way, that's verse 16 in Colossians chapter 3. Let the word of Christ dwell richly within you. There's a story of a Chinese farmer who was a Christian. He farmed some land on the side of a hill because that's all the land that he had. And there was a few other farmers on that hill as well. One of the most difficult tasks that the farmer had was to irrigate his land. Because he was at the top of the hill, he would have to walk down to the lake, carry water up to the top of the hill, and irrigate his farmland. However, he had a bad relationship with one of his neighbors. The neighbor that was directly below him, oftentimes when he would water his crops, the neighbor would go out and knock the dam that he had built down so that the water would flow down to his land and water his crops. And so this went on and this went on. The Christian farmer, wanting to be a good Christian, would swallow his anger and not say anything. But as time went on, the behavior of the non-Christian did not change, and he knew the answer to this non-Christian's problem was to be saved. But the more he knocked his dam down, and the more he had to walk up the hill and water both of the plots of land, the more angry he got, and the more his anger started to grow within his heart. And he started to harbor bad feelings about this neighbor, and his hatred grew and grew. Then one day, the Lord got a hold of this Christian farmer and told him a solution to his problem was that he needed to love his neighbor. So starting that next week, when he went to water his crops, he knocked down the dam himself. And every single time, he watered both plots of land. And a few weeks later, the non-Christian came to the Christian farmer and says, I don't know what happened to you, but because I've seen an amount of love in your heart that I've not had, I've accepted Christ as my Savior. That old saying goes, you can catch more flies with honey, or you can lead more people to the Lord with love. And you can help other people to grow with love. You want to see somebody change that's in your church? Love them. Pray for them. We're not called to a life of anger. We're called to put it off. And we're called to put off hate. And we're called to put on Christ. If you're here today and you say, man, I don't know how I'm ever going to love that person. I don't know how I'm ever going to get over the anger that's in my heart. I want to encourage you to seek Christ first. put on Christ and take off the sin, and I promise you, things will get better. Secondly, if you're here today and you say, well, you know, all this talk about putting these things off is fine and good, but I don't even know how to seek Christ. I've never sought Christ a day in my life. I want to encourage you. It's not a difficult thing. You just repent of your sin and turn to Christ, and He will change you from the inside out. Christ has already done all the work necessary to save you. You just have to submit to Him by faith. That is, trusting that He can save you. This morning is a time of invitation. But I want to ask you, Christian, I want to ask you, have you really dealt with the anger that's in your heart? Are you still harboring some anger for someone, maybe in the workplace, someone in your family, maybe someone in this room? I want to encourage you, give it to Christ and get rid of it. Because it's not doing anybody any good. In fact, it's probably doing some people some harm. Starting with you. Let's put off our anger. Let's pray together. Father, we come before You today recognizing that You've called us to something that is bigger than ourselves. You've called us to something that takes more effort than we can give. And You've called us to live a life that turns the other cheek, that is willing to forgive. Father, I pray this morning is a day that we deal with some anger in our hearts. We just give it to You. I pray that today is a day that we honor the calling on our lives from You to live holy, to live righteous, to live in proper love. Now today, as we enter this time of invitation, I pray that You will do a magnificent and mighty work in our hearts as we seek You. If there's someone lost here today, I pray that You'll save them in the name of Jesus and in the power of His blood. Use this time of invitation and we'll submit it to You. Stand with me with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. This is your time of invitation. Your time to come. Your time to deal with any sin that may be in your heart. This altar is open. You just spend some time in prayer with God right where you are. Or you come down here and lay it all on the altar. If you need to be saved, I'm here. If you need me to pray for you, I'm here. This is your time. You come. He knows my name, and he hears my thoughts. The person next to you might not know if you have anger in your heart. If you're their spouse, you might know. The person next to you might not know if you have anger in your heart, but he knows your every thoughts. Can we sing that chorus one more time? He knows my name.
He knows my name.
So the point of all that, he knows. Why don't you just give it to him? Why don't you just let him take your anger? He's willing to bear your burdens. All right? Let's close with a word of prayer today. Father, we come before you today. We're so eternally grateful for the blood of Jesus Christ, which does so much more than stamp us a ticket into heaven. It is a life-changing, transforming power that makes us not just members of the kingdom of God, but children. And so, Father, if there's someone here today that is not a child of yours, I pray, God, that you will help them to talk to someone about how they can be saved. But more than that, Lord, thank you that you can change us and deal with the sin in our own hearts. Use this opportunity of learning this lesson to transform us from the inside out. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's join hands.
Days of Elijah.
To enter into a special called conference at this time, so if you